What was your haha I'm in danger moment? So I was walking to my school, and there's this little street with two lanes that leads onto the highway that you need to pass to get to my school. I usually wait till everyone has passed since no one respects the yield, but that day, the guy in the right lane actually yielded, which was awesome. So I made my way across. Suddenly, as I passed through the right lane and entered the left lane, before my mind could process anything, my body just straight up stopped moving. I was briefly confused before I felt two cars barely graze both my front and backside. Apparently the guy on the right started driving again as soon as I was out of his lane. And at the same time, a guy behind him was being impatient and jumped to the left lane without stopping for me. So they both passed me at the same time while I survived by being frozen in the minor gap between the two. Honestly, my subconscious is the only reason I'm alive today. Both of those men need to be freaking arrested. Passing people at crosswalks needs to be a felony offense. I was on a bouncy castle at a college ball and my friend turned the pump off as a prank. My head was sealed in the deflating plastic and I was suffocating, kicking my legs wildly trying to free myself. I had almost passed out when someone noticed and pulled me out. It would have been quite an ignominious end. I was a camp counselor a few summers back and the lady running the bouncy castle shut it off without warning with like 10 of my kids still in it saying she was done with her shift. We were told we had 30 more minutes. Thankfully she turned it back on before it deflated too much, but I had to deal with a bunch of scared to death 5-year-olds for the rest of the day. When I was about 14, I chucked a teenage tantrum and went for an angry walk in the bushland behind my house. Didn't take my phone. Didn't tell anyone where I was going. Just stormed out. It started raining pretty heavily after about 45 minutes. So I turned back to head home. But a bridge I had crossed had been washed away and the creek was rising very rapidly. I, stupidly, skidded down the embankment to see if I could cross. But didn't realize the rain had made it too slippery for me to be able to climb back up. I vividly remember standing on the little patch of rock thinking, haha, I might die. I didn't. I climbed onto a rock ledge, waited out the storm and managed to make my way back up the embankment and return by a different route. By that point, had been gone for about 4 hours and had escaped death only to be almost killed by my parents. I didn't. Plot twist. When my intoxicated friend knocked over another guy's pint by accident and then his drunken brain decided he could take on the guy was built like a brick crap house, and his friends were all huge. They were the type of guys that don't take too kindly to being challenged to a fight. We were two skinny 19-year-olds. Anyway, I bought brick crap house guy a replacement drink, and somehow talked him and his mates down from flattening the pair of us, then drug my idiot friend out of the pub and got him home. Some people should moderate their drinking. By the way, the rule is, you spill another man's pint, you immediately apologize and buy the next round. Actually saw the guy again a few days later, small town, and he was cool about it. Smart move removing your friend from the pub before drugging him. Went to a neighbor's house to help him decide on how to rearrange his living room furniture. First thing he did was start playing music on his TV at full volume, then went to his back bedroom and asked me to come look at a chair in there. I dipped. This is so creepy, I hate it. The day I moved into a new apartment and noticed pry marks on the door. I was staying in a hotel in Manhattan and I woke up to 3 empty beer cans on my balcony. I didn't drink beer on my balcony. Private pilot story. Just on a return flight with a few mates back to local aerodrome. Look down at rudder pedals and notice the side of my shoe was basically starting to melt. First moment of realization that the engine was indeed on fire. Ha, I'm in danger. Couple of days ago I was working up a tree. Arborist. The tree in question was a black locust that was dying at the top. However, the base looked fine. I set about slowly dismantling the tree, which was an awkward task because I couldn't get as high up onto the tree as I wanted due to the decay and it was growing over a building, so I couldn't just let bits free fall. After an hour or so of working, I heard a snap about a meter above me while I was about 13 meters up into the crown. I looked up to see a long branch above me that was growing into the crown of another tree had snapped. I realized instantly that this meant that the base of the tree I was in had failed and I was going to go down with it if I didn't get out. Before I could even react, the tree was free falling down towards the outbuilding that I had been working so hard to avoid. Time slowed down and I could see my colleagues standing in the woodland watching me with pure fear on their faces. After that, it's hard to put my thoughts into words, but I remember looking down at where the tree was going to land and thinking that it's weird because this second I am completely lucid, but a second from not I will probably be unconscious, possible never to regain consciousness. Yet I didn't feel any panic, just a knowing that I'm in extreme danger. All I could do was grab the nearest branch and plant me feet on another one and hope to God that I didn't end up under any part of the tree. After what seemed like forever, the tree came down onto the roof of the outbuilding. I had probably traveled 10 meters vertically and about the same laterally. The large limbs of the tree that were previously to my right but were now above me didn't snap and crush me like I was sure they would. I managed to hold onto my branch and stayed roughly in the middle of the tree. I was free from injury other than a twisted ankle and a twinge in my wrist from holding on tight as the tree smashed down. I don't know how I didn't get seriously freaked up by that tree, and I don't know why it failed on me, but I will never forget that, knowing that I'm in danger, falling with tons of wood and there's nothing I can do about it. That was one heck of a story. I'm glad you didn't die. My third year fighting forest fire, I was upgraded to pump truck operator for a mop-up crew. After a section of the fire was deemed extinguished, they send in mop-up to make sure it's actually really out. I drove a giant pickup truck with a huge tank of soapy water and filled up portable water bags for the mop-up fighters. On my way back to base, I had a bit of water left when I saw plumes of white smoke. Your urge to extinguish all smoke, because no one wants a dead fire to come back to life. There's a fallen tree next to a bunch of bushes, and another half-fallen tree, and the half-fallen tree is spewing hot coals every couple seconds with a loud pop. Each pop of hot coals makes the other wood products take off. The fire was at risk of starting over again, right here lol. I had nothing but a peant bladder bag. I bounded down to the pump truck, grabbed the hose, ran it up, bounded down, turned the hose on, ran up, and began attacking the situation. As I'm chasing down the heat and fuel source, I realize I'm surrounded by flammable objects. Soon after, I'm surrounded by giant flames. Alone, I was literally screaming and laughing as I hacked and sprayed away at the rising flames. I got it tamed down after soaking and chopping killed the main source. I also sprayed the frick out of branches so soapy water was dripping everywhere. I had just finished rolling the hose back up and was catching my breath when these marines came running up the hill. They were sent to investigate the smoky mess I'd been dealing with. Being high-fived by a marine is a good feeling. When I was a teenager, my mother was in the hospital and I overheard my abusive stepfather answering the door at 2 a.m. and talking about getting rid of them tomorrow night and his gun. I was 100% sure he was going to kill my sister and me. Falling off a bridge into water right next to a stingray with dead sharks drifting by. I live in Australia. Of course, it's Australia. Going home from a party in a shared Uber with some friends. I mistook the street for another one and ended up further away from my apartment than I thought. I put the GPS on and of course it makes you take some back alley. At one I see some movement near a car and there is a guy looking at me. I pass him. Try to call my friend because he was looking weird. BTW, I did the wrong number and someone got a voicemail from me sounding totally terrified and spitting nonsense. I walk faster and look back. He is dunking behind another car and clearly switched from his original place. And he has a small knife in his hand. I bolted from here, ran as fast as possible with adrenaline and stopped after finding a busy street. But when I saw the knife, that's when it went oh crap. I'm glad you aren't stabbed. Attention all guest, a gorilla has escaped its enclosure. Please make your way to the nearest exit. Me realizing I'm in the primate area. Ah. Get in the gorilla enclosure, since it's not in there. When I was about 12, a friend from our local church drove me and his sons to go swimming at a creek near where we lived. I didn't know how to swim yet, but he assured me that I'd be fine since there wasn't much water and it could be a good learning experience. So far, pretty normal stuff. It gets weird though. The water was much deeper than expected and he did nothing to help on several occasions when I almost drowned. I was supposed to stay at his house overnight, but wasn't feeling very good after breathing in water a few times. Plus, something obviously didn't feel right. He was mumbling to himself while he put his shoes back on after swimming. Good thing I stayed home. Turns out he was off his medication. My family didn't know that he had previously killed a person during a hunting trip when he was in his early teens. The night I decided to go home, he went off the rails. He believed the world was going to end and tried to kill his entire family. When my family went to church that Sunday, we didn't see his family. The pastor told us what happened. They all had miraculously survived, but he was now in lockup for his serious issues. TLDR. Almost drowned. Almost killed. Family friend was a murderer and we didn't know it. Drunk in Amsterdam, wheeling around a guy in a wheelchair we met. We were like 18, the guy in the wheelchair 30 something. Well, we ended up in a dark alley and five tall sketchy dudes surrounded us, but I was too drunk and happy to realize it was a threat and chatted happily with them. They started asking for money and I was like, haha, no. All of a sudden this queen of a woman stepped inside the circle and told the guys frick off. They're with me. Had a nice chat with her. Then we wheeled the guy in the wheelchair home. The next day I realized she saved our butts. Wait, who TF was the girl though? She must have been someone the guys knew, or surely they would have just robbed her too. I drove through a notorious neighborhood back in my hometown and the engine had become entirely cut off. Apparently my dumbass had it on third gear for a couple of hours. I got robbed that night, but thankfully there was no carjacking. Not so easy to jack a car if you have to do so by pushing it away. Mom. 14 missed calls. That means the same thing in a different way when you're older and live out of state from your parents. Mom. 14 missed calls. Oh crap. I'm dead. Mom. 14 missed calls. Oh crap. Grandma's dead. I was on holiday and had left my hotel to walk to Livingstone National Park in Zimbabwe. My friends had visited earlier in the day and wanted to stay by the pool, so I figured I'd walk over by myself, since it wasn't a particularly long trip. The easiest route from my hotel was following a small path between some bushes and trees. I'd been down the path before, but this time there were families of baboons walking down this path and no other person. I cracked on anyway, figuring that as long as I wasn't waving food around or getting too close, I'd be fine. Apparently I must have done the latter and unintentionally stepped too close to one of their young, because one of the full-grown adult baboons jumped out in front of me and started howling at me, baring its teeth. Because of the noise it was making, it attracted the attention of all the other baboons, and two other full-grown adults soon joined the first in howling and showing serious aggression all of a couple of yards in front of me and to my side. I had no idea if there were more behind me, but my instinct in the situation was to hold up my hands to show empty palms, stand tall, broad and start stepping backwards and away slowly. Thankfully it worked and they eventually turned away and carried on. But for a short while my mind was having flashes of being torn apart by three baboons. I later found out their bites can break human bones, so I'm pretty lucky that my instinct in the situation was the correct one. If Bro Rogan has taught me anything, it's that monkeys and apes are death-dealing demons that desperately want to rip off your feet and genitals before chewing on your face. I agree, you handled that situation very appropriately. The moment I arrived for work at a bank, stepped inside and had a stranger say happy April Fools and put a revolver against my temple. Two robbers, both with revolvers and rifles, had made their way inside before opening and had bailed up the manager as he arrived and then the staff as they arrived. They were talking to a third accomplice on walkie-talkies. I was told to lie with my face down on the ground, arms on my back and legs together. One robber was going down the line hog tying staff with cable ties while the other had the manager and supervisors unlocking safes. All along there were threats not to look or move or you would be shot. The robber had just tied my wrists together, with the pistol lying on the ground between my legs, when I heard a commotion. A staff member had managed to exit while they were distracted and the robbers followed him and left the bank quickly. They got nothing. All in all, I was there, with 15 other staff, for about 35 minutes. I was living with a man I'd known for a month. Nick be like that. And one day I left without saying anything to him. I was at McDonald's and he texted and asked if I was at Papa John's, which was across from McDonald's. Thought oh creepy. Then I got home and we had a conversation where he started talking about something I'd just texted my girlfriend about, and it was a topic we had never discussed before. Red flag. I am in danger. All the times he seemed to be in the right place at the right time, had food for me when I hadn't eaten, hit me all at once. Found out dude had spyware on my phone and was watching my every move. When I was in year 5, I ate this cake which had one of those little bits of weird edible paper on them. In about 2 hours I felt my windpipe slowly shrinking, so I took some antihistamine tablets, but it was still getting worse. About half an hour after that, we called the hospital and I lay down while I was getting injected with my EpiPen. The ambulance came just when I was literally thinking I'm going to freaking die. They have me oxygen for about half an hour straight and took me to hospital. It was about midnight and I remember watching a rugby game on TV in the waiting room. I left the hospital at about 2 a.m. Basically, I almost died from a trace of peanuts. But the worst part was that I still had school the next day. Ouch, I mean the school part. Getting home from school with a SWAT team prepping to breach my apartment building. Slept at my sister's that night. When we were driving at night in India and a huge trailer truck pulled out in front of us and our driver just kept going, not even a tap on the brakes, missed that metal monstrosity by a few breathtaking feet. Actually, all of driving in India is an I'm in danger moment. When I was 18 years old, I was living in my first apartment by myself. I had no roommates and my parents had just moved states. My downstairs neighbors were a group of 20-somethings who had lots of traffic. Constantly people coming and going. Parties multiple times per week. Rarely saw the same people twice. One day, I noticed a blacked out van in one of the parking lots. I swear I saw a camera with a long, long lens through the heavily tinted windows, but I just kind of brushed it off. Maybe it's paranoia. Over the next 3 days, I see more and more surveillance. Vans, sedans, trucks. All of them mirror black and limo tint windows. They would sit there for 8 or so hours at a time and another vehicle would rotate in and relieve the post. Then, quick as they came, they disappeared one day. Now I'm getting concerned. I have no idea what is going on, but someone is definitely watching my apartment building. 2 weeks after I saw the last surveillance vehicle, I go out on my balcony for a smoke. That's when I see the cops. Holy crap, so many freaking cops. They were stacked up, breaching style, on the sides of the building adjacent to me. There were probably 24 uniformed officers. Suddenly, they fan out, guns drawn and aimed at my building. They take up defensive positions and are yelling at each other. One of them motions at me aggressively to go inside. Then a file of a dozen SWAT officers begin closing in on my building, walking right up the path. I'm crapping my pants now because I've got like a half ounce of weed and alcohol in my house and there's 40 cops outside. I go inside and hide everything as best as I can and go to the window that faces outside so I can watch this crazy crap go down. The neighbors below me got raided. The SWAT team fired a launcher of some sort through their windows. I heard 5 loud pops followed by acrid smoke wafting through my vents. They forcefully entered the apartment and I heard so freaking many shots. One small caliber pop followed by a roar of semi-automatic rifle fire. Must have been 100 rounds. I threw myself on the floor of my apartment as I listened to the supersonic crack of rounds missing. It seemed to never stop. I guess the neighbors were major players in the drug game and one of them pulled a gun during the raid, so the SWAT team killed all 3 of them. The apartment building was condemned and I had to move back in with my parents. After the fact, I realized how lucky I was to not get shot on my balcony or struck by a stray round in my home. Sometimes I have flashbacks and nightmares to that moment. My face on the uncomfortably thick carpet, blue-gray smoke in the apartment, glass shattering, drywall cracking, rounds flying. For future reference, if the people below you are shooting bullets and you lay down on the floor, you technically give them a bigger target to shoot at if they accidentally angle their gun at all upwards. Standing might have been the better move, but behind a wall not looking out any windows. Stood between my mate and a guy in a motorcycle gang during a bar altercation. Didn't think that one through, and luckily made it out without injury. My GF and I were driving home from the beach. Around 2 a.m. on an empty street, some guy jumps out of nowhere in front of the car. I thought he jumped in front of the car on accident, but then I realized he had a baseball bat in his hand and he was charging towards us. As soon as I realized that he was coming towards us, I booked it around him and sped off. I'm 99% sure this guy was going to try to rob us, but it all happened so fast I didn't process what happened until later. When I was younger, I walked to 711 with my older cousin who was like 12, I think, and I didn't really get what was going on, but I now realize some guys were following us in a white van and that's why she wouldn't let me stop walking at all. Also, happy cake day, lol. A little over a year ago, my mother helped a Pakistani girl escape from her abusive family and get into an asylum center, where she'd be able to change her identity and start her life over. The girl had been in my mother's class when she was teaching at an asylum school, and was still in contact with some of her students, including this girl. My mom of course knew that the family wouldn't be happy, but thought it was worth the risk since this girl really needed help. She of course told me about it, and gave me a heads up to be careful when walking around town for the next period of time, etc., but I didn't really think much of it. Fast forward to around a week after my mom had helped the girl. It was around 3 a.m. on a weekend and I was just about to fall asleep, when my mom suddenly came tiptoeing into my room with the most terrified freaking expression, and just told me, "Don't say anything. Someone's at the door." Apparently my mom had woken up to the doorbell being rung around 70 times, along with a picture of our front door sent from an unknown number. She had heard voices as well, and had worked it out to be around 4-5 dudes standing out there. This somehow managed to find my mom's address and phone number, and we had no way to know if they just wanted to talk, or had worse intentions. I don't really know how, but I managed to stay chill the entire time, while my mom was almost crying in fear. All my thoughts were basically just one big pile of haha, we're in danger. We called the police, who showed up half an hour after they had already left, and basically responded to the whole thing with, "Yeah, we can't do anything about that." Summer before my senior year in high school, my friends and I would float down the river on inner tubes. The first float that summer, we ran over a downed tree across the channel, with about 6 inches of water running over the trunk. 3 people in front of me skidded over the top. I was sitting on a semi-truck tube, and it flipped out from under me. The current dragged me down and I doubled over a branch. Full force of the current held me there and the impact forced me to exhale. There was no way to struggle back to the surface against the water. I worked my way over the branch and dove for the bottom. When I found the sandy mud, again I turned with the current, put my face in the mud to shield my eyes, and worked my way downstream. I could feel the branches digging into my back while I wondered if I'd get stuck again. I was curious, not really scared yet. Meanwhile, GF, who started immediately in front of me, was standing on a sandbar and facing upstream waiting for me to show up. I surfaced downstream and had to wait for tube to catch up. That's when I got scared. My husband grew up off-roading. I did not. We were living in high desert plains and there was a lot of it directly behind our house and going for miles. We went with his dad. They were both on motorcycles and I was following on a quad. I'd like to point out it was manual and it was the first and only manual vehicle I have ever driven. They are hauling butt and I'm just trying to keep up without messing up the machine. They go up this hill that wraps around the back of it and goes back down. The corner and downward slope are blind until you get around. They were a good distance ahead of me and when I came around the corner they are waving at me to stop, but it was too late. That year we had a lot of monsoons and they had eaten out a gully down the center of the trail that started as soon as you rounded the corner. There was drop off on the right side. It was completely uneven ground on either side, so at no point were all my tires on the ground. I tried to stop but I was being bounced violently back and forth with the entire quad. To make matters worse, I can see an old tea stake sticking out of the ground. I assume it was cut off below ground level when a fence was moved, but the rain had exposed 2 inches of it. It was in the middle of the trail. I knew I was screwed. Get to the bottom of the hill and the quad flips on its side. It threw me into the gully, and the quad tottered above me on the edge of the gully. My Phil and husband run over and are freaking out. They thought I landed on the T-stake and they were going to be rushing me to the hospital. Meanwhile, I'm using the leg I didn't land on to stabilize the quad, yelling for them to flip it back because I thought I smelt gas. I missed the stake but not even a 1-stroke 4 inch. It wasn't touching me but my shirt was on it. If I fell 1 inch back or even an inch to my left, it would have been catastrophic. I got away with a knee injury I didn't even go to the doctor for. No damage to the quad, but he sold it soon after and got a newer manual model. I was walking home late one night after a party at a friend's house. On my way home, I usually pass by this building that has a pack of stray dogs hanging out in the parking lot at night. Now, where I live, there's no animal control, so these dogs are a bit aggressive, and until that day I had never gotten home so late. I figured there is a chance I might come across them, but I thought, nah, they ain't gonna eat me or whatever. Well, I was passing by the building and guess what I heard? Angry barking from the parking lot and the sound of dogs running in my direction. My first reaction was to start running, cause I wasn't gonna let them eat me or anything. After a few paces I realized if I run they're gonna keep chasing me. Instincts. So I stopped and this huge pack of like 10 dogs comes to me and starts barking like crazy. I have my back against the wall, facing them so I can do something if they try to bite. After about 10 minutes of non-stop barking I figured they won't let me go and I obviously fight them off, so I just squatted down and said, "Hey there, buddy," to one of them, just in case I could get them to calm down. Turns out the fellas just wanted some attention and someone to play with. Played with them for about 15 minutes and they even followed me home after that. Loved this. Actually, I'm super scared of something like that happening to me as I'm really cautious with stray dogs. So, just felt your fear ending this and felt so happy with the ending. Thanks. My teacher taking my computer and revising my homework folder. Honestly, even if they found something, they shouldn't be snooping all up in your crap. My mom asked if she could use my phone for something. She said she needed to search up something, then it hit me. That dang search history. P. Taking 4 left turns and 2 man still behind me. Told a boy to frick off, then discovered he had a gun and expressed wishes to kill someone. When I was around 10, my parents were getting heated arguments and asked me to choose a side, no matter what I lost. I never forgave my mother for pulling that crap with me. Out at a party with friends when I was supposed to be studying at the library, and checking my phone to see 4 missed calls from my dad and 6 from my mum. My heart nearly stopped beating. I was 20 and partying at a real sketchy dive bar. I met up with this cute guy and his friend. He wanted me to go with him and his friend to an empty park outside town for fricking. Young drunk me didn't even hesitate. It's very rare to meet attractive young gay men, and even more so to score 2. We got into his truck. I sat in front and his friend sat behind me. That kinda made me uneasy since he was directly behind me. They were insisted I just take it easy. The entire time his friend had a dark look on his face. A look that made me really afraid. We stop at a gas station and the main guy gets out to pay for the gas. I'm uneasy, something is giving me a bad vibe and his friend is making me seriously uncomfortable. I try to get out but the friend locks me in. He tells me to relax and stop trying to get out. At this point I'm sweating bullets. Something is very off. A few minutes later the main guy returns with another freaking guy. At this point I realize I'm in some serious crap. Person C is a friend too and has a real mean look about him. They insist he's just a friend and I need to relax. No, I'm not going to, cause it's clear this is an abduction. We stop at a red light. The door's unlocked. I unbuckle and bolt out the door before they react. Nearly get hit by a car but I run alongside the road and don't stop till I reach the gas station. I head out behind the gas station and jump into the dumpster to hide. My fears they were chasing me were confirmed when I heard them talking. I stayed till morning before leaving and calling a friend to help. Scariest moment of my life. Fourth car at an intersection in the U-turn lane. First car does a burnout and pulls a drift U-turn. I WTCH as the car starts sliding my way. I can't move out of the way because the car in front of me hasn't moved yet. Did not get hit, but did have a "so this is how I go" moment. Hiking in Pictured Rocks National Park along Lake Superior. Husband dropped me off at one trailhead. I'd hike 10 miles. He'd pick me up. No cell service along the trail. A 10-yard portion of this trail is built into a cliff. It's narrower than my hiking shoe. There's a sheer drop down to the lake to my left. The turquoise water is full of huge boulders. I notice the trail is severely undercut. I look up at the cliff. Way too steep to try to climb up and over to avoid the trail. No better way to sum up my thoughts than haha, I'm in danger. Of course everything was fine, but it was a very careful, nerve-wracking 30 feet of walking. When I was about 9, my mom, 6 siblings and I were living in MN just temporarily for like 3 months. So we were borrowing my grandpa's super old 12-passenger van. We were going on a day trip to our friend's campsite, an hour or two's drive, when the van started having issues. It was stalling and then eventually just stopped running. So my mom had the car pulled over on the side of the rural country road between a cornfield and a cemetery. She was trying to get the car to start again when she noticed smoke coming out of the AC and yelled, "Everybody get out!" My sisters and I grabbed the babies out of their car seats and ran. By the time we'd gotten 100 yards from the van, it was completely engulfed in flames. Me and my sisters were just standing in the cemetery watching the metal burn and listening to the tires explode as my mom called 911. We were worried the flames would spread from the car to the cornfield and the whole area would go up in flames, but luckily the firefighters got there before that could happen. After they put the fire out, you could hardly even tell that it had once been a vehicle. It was so mangled. I don't even remember being that scared, just having the instinct to protect my little siblings, who did not even realize they were in danger. In fact, my 2-year-old sister's biggest concern was that we didn't save her princess coloring book. TLDR, car burned up, hung out in a cemetery, saved ungrateful baby. Saved ungrateful baby, best part. Customer came in around 4 a.m. mumbling under his breath and acting real weird with another customer who came in shortly after him. Next thing I know they're almost fighting and then the first customer starts pouring charcoal lighter fluid on the cigarette case before trying to open up one of the long tipped lighter packages so he can start the lighter fluid on fire. I almost drowned in a pool at my summer camp when I explicitly told the counselor I do not know how to swim and her saying everyone else is in the pool, you get in too and pushing me into the deep end. I was 6 years old, everything kind of went in slow motion and I feel sorry for the people that actually do die underwater because it's the worst feeling in the world when you can look up and see the surface. You know it's right there and you can breathe if you just swim up to it, but you can't. I was under the water for 45 seconds but it felt like an hour. Imagine being 6 years old and thinking no one sees me, I'm going to die, because that's what I felt. Luckily, one angel of a counselor saw me at the bottom of the pool and all I remember is seeing these two hands with long, fiery red nails reaching out and grabbing me by the waist to hoist me out of the water. She gave the other counselor who pushed me in a real good yelling at and I was traumatized. If it weren't for her, I likely would have drowned that day. TW. Death the next day. Okay. I have several but this one haunts me to this day. I live in Alaska. I hike alone a lot. My boyfriend at the time was out of town. So I decided to take my trusty dog and my tiny new puppy for a hike. I figured it would be about an hour or two unless I get distracted taking photos of the dogs. I always let someone know where I am at and what time I should check in after my hike. So I am hiking down a fairly busy trail but no one was around. So I am humming and watching my dogs play with each other. A stumbling puppy trying to keep up with her big brother is so cute. I get about 5 minutes into the trail when all of a sudden my oldest dog freezes and puffs up. Then he starts letting out this growl that I have never heard before and my heart just stops. Right in front of me was a giant bear, standing I want to say like 20 feet from me, staring. I start crying, and my puppy is now hiding between my legs. My dog and this bear are staring down growling at each other. What felt like hours passing by, my dog barked and the bear walked away, but I had a gut feeling he didn't go far. So I scooped up my puppy, and just started walking super fast crying, and then eventually turned into a run. My oldest dog stayed behind me stopping and looking. I ran so fast I could see the parking lot. I get into the parking lot and I sit in my Jeep. I saw the bear in the tree line as I was driving away. The next day there were some teenagers preparing for a race and a boy went out alone, had been chased by a bear, killed and eaten. He was found a few hours later cause the bear kept chasing people. I don't hike that trail anymore because the following summer 3 people have been mauled or killed by a bear. They say it's a different bear cause they shot the other one. But I am curious why all of a sudden bears are attacking more and more. I have had my encounter with bears but none like this. This bear wasn't afraid of me. He stood his ground. He followed me. He watched. I have never seen a bear do that before. Now I have 4 large dogs. I carry bear spray when hiking. And have a husband who joins my hikes. Funny story. My mom is a bear guide so I am constantly seeing bears. And I am so afraid of bears. I was young and mad at my mom for not letting me play outside. So I stormed off, and after I turned a corner and was out of sight, I spun around and gave her the bird. Well, guess who walked around the corner right as I did that? I was 15, in Libya in 1998, walking home from school. I'm 10 minutes from where I live, and a gold Mazda 626 pulls over, and the driver asks me, "Hey young man, you know where the Beera family live?" "Sure do. They're in that neighborhood over there," I said, pointing to my neighborhood. "Hop in, I'll give you a ride." "Okay." You gotta understand that at that time people were without malice mostly, and it was generally safe. So I hop in. At the light he was supposed to turn left, but turns right. Need to pick up my brother from Ziz middle school. I'm leery, but okay. He turns to head towards Ziz middle school, and speeds up as we pass it. Bells start going off in my head. Frick. This is the end. I look at his dash for whatever reason and see he's going about 55 miles per hour and gaining. I look up, I see a bridge. On the other side of it is nothing but country, and I really didn't stand a chance if I didn't get out now in front of this school. I open the door, and he pulls out a knife. "Close the door, you son of a W." At that point I say nope, and fear takes over, thinking I could run slow myself down from 55 miles per hour. Feet hit the ground, face hits next. Next thing I know I'm looking up, he's gone. People are WT failing and my books are all over the road. A broken nose and sprained ankle later, I'm alive, and well and 37 today, in Florida. But man, I'll never forget that day. It may explain my trust issues with strangers. You have been visited by the Holy Doggo. Like and subscribe, you magnificent person.